This is the Tesla Model Y, the best-selling EV in America. It weighs 4,388 pounds and has over 10,000 parts. The most important parts in the car are in the rear drive unit. This unit weighs 194 pounds, less than 5% of the total weight of the car. But inside that unit, deep in the rotor of the rear motors, you'll find the real secret: magnets. These magnets generate the magnetic field that helps produce torque in the motor shaft. And buried inside those magnets, just 1.1 pounds of it is the magic ingredient: rare earth metals. 0.02% the weight of the Tesla Model Y. And without them, the car would be less powerful, less efficient, more expensive, and more complex. 1.1 pounds, and a world of difference. So where do these rare earth metals even come from? About 70% of all rare earth production comes from China, with the US representing 11.6%. But it gets worse. You see, these metals require significant refining. Refining that is energy intensive and heavy polluting. China represents 92% of refined material production globally. That means China controls whether or not the world has an EV revolution. But it's not just EVs. Military equipment, AI data centers, and dozens of other high technology applications rely on tiny, tiny bits of rare earth. Without them, the US is disadvantaged, and Trump, he knows this, as does China. On October 9th, 2025, China published Announcement Number 62 of 2025. In it, they introduced new rules that require foreign companies to gain approval to export products where rare earths account for just 0.1% of the good's total value. President Trump reacted swiftly. He threatened to impose an additional 100% tariff on Chinese goods. This is how China turned dirt into dominance. Rare earth minerals are 17 metallic elements at the bottom of the periodic table that are crucial for modern technology. Everything from phones, EVs, wind turbines, fighter jets, they all need these minerals. Like we mentioned before, a Tesla Model Y has about 0.5 kilograms of rare earth compared to its total weight of around 1,884 kilograms. Although small in quantity, the impact is massive. And unlike most of the world, China saw this coming decades ago. As recently as 1991, the US was the leading global supplier of rare earths. This was all thanks to the Mountain Pass mine in California, but more on that later. But since then, China has become the dominant player. Take a look at these charts. Like mentioned before, China currently represents 70% of all rare earth production, with the US far behind at just 11.6%. But don't these minerals need to be processed? Well, like we showed before, China represents 92% of refined material production globally.
And demand is expected to increase from 91 kT in 2024 to 150 by 2040.
In other words, China dominates the one mineral that the modern world can't live without. But how did we get from the US being the global leader to China having a near monopoly on rare earths? Let's get into it. During the Cold War, China was watching the US closely. They learned that rare earths were the backbone of some of America's most important industries. They were essential in petroleum refining, precision hardware, metallurgy, and most importantly, military hardware. China understood that if it were to ever compete against the US, it would need to develop a strong military capability, an insurance policy of sorts. So in 1975, China established the National Rare Earth Development and Application Leading Group. This led to a meaningful ramp-up of research and development funding. As a part of this, China sent over scientists and geologists to visit the US Mountain Pass mine, the largest rare earth mine at the time. The CEO of Molycorp, a processing company at Mountain Pass, was quoted saying, "We toured them, we explained what we do, allowed them to take pictures, and everything else. They studied ore composition, mine design, processing techniques, and more. In fact, they even took rock samples home." The US thought nothing of it. In fact, they welcomed Chinese researchers as they believed this would help China on its path to democracy and global trade partnership. And how can you blame them? Rare earths were, and remain, a small segment of mining. Businessman Mitchell Presnick recalls a meeting with a Chinese mining company in the 90s. This is what he said. "They knew that rare earths were more important than we seem to be acting like. As a result, China used its newfound knowledge to identify similar mineralization at the Bayan Obo site in Inner Mongolia, a site that would become the dominant rare earth mine globally. But it went further than taurine sites. The Chinese needed the know-how to make the most important product from rare earths, magnets. In 1995, the US government approved the sale of MagnaQuench, the rare earths and magnet division of General Motors. Who was at sale to? Well, a group of Chinese companies. Initially, they maintained the US factories, but they rapidly built up factories in China, and eventually, they shuttered all US facilities. Shifting the capacity, know-how, innovation to China. Brilliant. What could go wrong? Based on everything we have said so far, China's approach seems perfectly calculated and centrally planned. But that's not completely true. In 1991, China passed a law calling rare earths strategic. This restricted foreign companies from working with Chinese companies. At around the same time, it introduced tax rebates to encourage domestic production. The race was on, and Chinese cowboys were lined up. The industry was highly unregulated and crowded with small mines and refineries viciously competing. This would drive down prices so aggressively that business made no sense. Not only was it bad for business, but it was just bad for the environment. They would scar the earth and pay very little mind to practices related to structural stability, environmental management, and more. It got so bad that a Chinese media investigation in 2012 compared the rare earths industry in China to the trafficking of illegal drugs. Illegal drugs! China attempted many times to wrangle the industry, but local governments were drunk on mining revenues. But as it became increasingly apparent that rare earths were the future, the Chinese government had had enough. Starting in 2011, authorities were instructed to audit mines unannounced, seize assets, destroy illegal mines, and more. Within 4 years, China went from dozens of small players to only six super-sized firms, nicknamed the Big Six. And not Big Six Hero, but I love that movie. This consolidation has a number of benefits. For one, the government has an easier time tracking extraction, production, and exports all across the country. This basically destroyed the smuggling that previously accounted for 30% of China's rare earth product. But most importantly, this created an oligopoly that could unilaterally control prices. To put it in perspective, OPEC controls around 40% of global oil production. China controls 90% of refined rare earth production. Crazy. When it comes to rare earths, it's China's world and we're just living in it. Real quick, we have a free Discord community where we talk about economics, politics, you can debate with us, we're actually in there, we message quite often, so join, link in the bio, and make sure you subscribe if you haven't already. Now back to the video. Any objective observer would agree that China was super thoughtful in cementing its rare earth dominance, but China had a helping hand from the West, obviously unintentionally. We already mentioned that the US let Chinese scientists study at their most important mine, and how they let Chinese companies buy an extremely sophisticated company and shift all IP abroad. But what we didn't mention is how the West, all by itself, helped bury the rare earth industry. In 2005, China tightened exports of rare earths, driving prices up. This made it increasingly difficult for defense companies and automakers to reliably access cheap raw materials. In fact, Molycorp actually tried reviving Mountain Pass to introduce domestically manufactured magnets back to the US. And it made sense. Prices of rare earths were high enough for US companies to be profitable. But in 2012, the Obama administration, the EU, and Japan sued China at the WTO. They accused China of using export quotas to restrict rare earth supplies abroad. In 2014, the WTO ruled against China, concluding its export quotas were unfair. China said, okay, we'll abandon them. And guess what happened? Sales to the US surged and prices collapsed. Our good friend Molycorp, well, they went bankrupt and America had zero rare earth mines. So it might be important to take a second and really think about this. The US was aware of the strategic importance of rare earths. In fact, the Gao's 2010 report on rare earths explicitly warned of potential supply disruptions for defense. But they failed to realize that the only way to protect against this was to have a local failsafe. Instead, the lawsuit ended up destroying the only protection that they had. What's more is that in 2006, China had listed new energy vehicles as one of its top 16 priority technologies for national development. By 2008, they launched the 863 Program EV Initiative, pouring funding into battery R&D and hybrid prototypers. And in 2009, they launched the 10 Cities 1,000 Vehicles pilot, subsidizing fleets of electric buses and taxis in major cities. All of this to say is that what China had realized is that rare earths were key to this. In fact, they discussed this openly. The US didn't even contemplate this in their lawsuit against China. Just think about how absurd that is. Their main focus was getting rare earths for defense. Defense! They didn't even think that rare earths could be a linchpin to future dominance in EVs. By the way, we made a whole video about the military-industrial complex. If you're interested, we'll link it in the description. While the US fumbled over itself on environmental policy, China executed the greatest comeback in industrial history. And now, finally, the US had realized they underestimated China. The demand for rare earths is expected to continue to increase over the next few decades. The value of the mineral is not in the commodity, but what it enables. EVs, robotics, AI, defense systems, and much, much more. By 2040, China's dominance is expected to decrease slightly. Instead of 90%, only 78% of rare earths will be refined in China, and 12% from Malaysia. Malaysian production is seen as the West's alternative to China and strategic hedge. But even that is nonsense. Refined production from Malaysia will likely need to go through China to make those juicy magnets that everyone needs. One of the key issues is that China has the know-how, but also they are willing to handle the environmental costs. Refining for rare earths requires strong acids, toxic tailings, and often leads to significant water and soil contamination. In fact, many would argue that the repeated radioactive wastewater leaks and tightening EPA regulations made it unprofitable to operate in the US. Not only that, China has a no-nonsense energy policy that uses whatever it can. Not all hope is lost, though. The West is contemplating new technologies, ionic clay leaching, solvent recycling, and more. But these technologies are 2 to 4 times more expensive as China. And frankly, China has an advantage in them too. The reality, China is way ahead of the West, and unless they get their act together, this will continue to be negotiating leverage that few can compete against. When one country can decide your future, you listen. Those who know do not speak. Those who speak do not know. The master does not seek to conquer, yet all are conquered. Thank you for watching. Subscribe to 2 & 20 for more on economics and politics.